Welcome everybody, my name is Gunther from cinema5d.com and today we are going to take a look at the Zcam E2 F6 from the Chinese company Zcam. I have visited the zoo for some real world footage as well as our lab at cinema5d.com to test rolling shutter, dynamic range and latitude. Today is a beautiful day and I'm visiting Schönbrunn in Vienna, Austria with my family. But this time we are not interested in the palace, which is worth an entire day on its own, but rather the Zoo Schönbrunn. The Zoo Schönbrunn is the oldest zoo in the world and was established already in the year 1752 by the Emperor Franz and his wife Maria Theresia. Shooting today is not so easy as the lighting conditions are constantly changing. It's a bit windy, there are clouds in an otherwise blue sky with the sun coming back and forth all the time. This footage was shot in 4K DCI ProRes with C-Log2, noise reduction off and sharpness on weak. This camera does not offer any kind of image stabilization, so good lenses which offer optical stabilization are needed, if you go for handheld shooting as I did. Also, I have tested the various autofocus options but didn't find them to be reliable enough. So all the way manual focusing for these shots. You may ask why I have not used the highest quality Z-RAW, which the camera offers as well. Basically, for me the big selling point is the internal ProRes recording, and the Z-RAW data rates are just too much to handle for me and my computer. So ProRes, all the way, as that was my focal point of this review. My initial impressions after watching the zoo footage, wow! The Zcam E2 F6 has a wonderful image, very detailed, beautiful colors, out of the box. And the full frame look is just gorgeous, combined it with 6K ProRes 422 10-bit internal recording, high frame rates up to 4K 120 in 2.4 aspect ratio, and you have a winner. The body feels very solid and it has a very professional locking EF mount. I'm personally not the biggest fan of a locking EF mount because in the field, if the camera is not on a tripod, it's quite difficult to swap lenses. There is a lot to like about this minimalistic approach of Seacam. The body has multiple mounting options and you can build up this camera any way you like, essentially. The knobs and the buttons are now much more responsive than when I tested the Seacam E2 a year ago. That's a very nice improvement indeed. If you know the other Seacams, then the menu will feel very familiar with you. But it takes some time to get used to it, to be honest. Battery life is great. And a Sony NPF 970 battery basically lasts the whole day. I've used it in Schönbrunn when I shot the footage before, and it took me about 5 hours to record 45 minutes of footage, and the battery was still quite good after that. Also, all Seacams can be controlled via the Seacam app on your smartphone, which also offers a live view with not too much latency. A very nice feature, I have to say. And of course, before I forget, all the high frame rate modes this camera has to offer, including a 4K 120 frames per second mode, are amazing. The 4K 120 frames per second mode is available in Super 35 mode at the 1 to 2.4 aspect ratio. Alright, fine, but now let's discuss some not so nice features. The audio, for example. The automatic audio gain is basically unusable. You can completely forget about it. It would constantly swap back and forth between the audio levels, so forget it. The manual gain option is fine. The boot up time of this camera is about 11 seconds until it is fully operational. So if you want to quickly grab a shot, it definitely takes too long to boot up the camera. Moving on, let's have a look at some lab results. First of all, the rolling shutter. Rolling shutter in 6K DCI 17x9 full frame mode is 20.1 milliseconds. This is a rather okay value for a full frame sensor. I would say it's in the middle field. There are some faster sensors out there, like the Canon C500 Mark II, for example, which comes in at 15.8 milliseconds, but still it's quite good. You can also switch this camera to Super 35 mode. And in the Super 35 mode, again in 4K DCI 17x9, the rolling shutter 13.4 milliseconds. Also a quite good value for a Super 35 camera. Next up is dynamic range of this camera. As you might know from our previous lab results, we use Exila 21 step chart, which displays 21 stops of latitude. And shooting this chart, we can see a waveform, here it is. What you notice is that actually there's very little noise floor present in the footage, meaning that there's very little noise at the bottom of the stops. Counting the stops down from the highlights to the bottom, I would identify about 12 stops that this camera has. So you might ask, why 12 stops? Because you can still see a 13th and a 14th stop. The problem is that between the 12th and the 13th and the 14th stop, there's no amplitude difference. No amplitude difference means there's basically no code values in between and it's unusable. Unfortunately, you can see in the IMATEST result chart that the lower stops are not identified correctly. It's no difference in the signal to noise ratio between the 12th and 13th stop is displayed. Also, beyond the 13th stop, no further patches of the step chart are identified. So we cannot trust this result, and this is why I did another test. I had my Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 6K at hand, and I looked at the real live high dynamic range scene. In this scene, you can see I exposed the highlights in exactly the same way on both cams side by side, and then I graded the footage to basically lift the shadows and have a look how noisy the shadows are. And in that side-by-side comparison, you can see that actually the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 6K result is a little less noisier and cleaner than the Zcam E2 F6 result. As we have rated previously the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera at 11.8 stops, usable dynamic range, I would say the Zcam E2 F6 comes in slightly below that. About 11.5 stops is the Cinema 5D dynamic range rating of this camera. And for a full frame 6K sensor, this is a bit disappointing, meaning you will have a hard time digging into the shadows of your footage because simply there's not much left in the shadows to dig into. By the way, at ISO 2500, which is the second native ISO of this dual native ISO sensor, we get exactly the same results. This is a very good result. Typically, there is a slight difference between the two dual native ISOs. On this camera, it's not. Next up is our Cinema 5D latitude or underexposure test. What we do is we shoot a studio scene, you can see it here, with Nino's face exposed at about 60% luma value on the waveform. We adjusted the studio lights that we have a base exposure of f4 at 360 degree shutter angle. And then we successively underexpose the footage by decreasing the shutter angle to 180, 90, 45, 22.5 and 11.25, meaning that we successively underexpose the footage up to 5 stops. And what we do then in DaVinci Resolve, we push up the footage again using the lift gamma gain controls until we get the same zero base exposure value, and we control this of course again with the waveform charts to get exactly the same exposure levels. And this is a very good test, and it shows also how well the footage can be pushed around and how well also sharpness, colors, details are maintained. Pushing back the 3 stops underexposed scene reveals already quite some noise, but I would say colors and details are well maintained and it's still usable. However, in the dark areas of the image you can see signs of banding posterization. That's the reason why I mentioned before that only about 11.5 stops of dynamic range are usable. In the darker areas there are not enough code values between the stops for a smooth transition. The same thing, of course more pronounced, happens at 4 stops of underexposure. Yes, you can use noise reduction to improve the image, but the banding won't go away. Also the noise in the shadow area behind Nino becomes excessive. So 3 stops under is clearly the limit here. Just for reference, here is the 5 stops underexposed image pushed back. But I was curious if 0 would lead to better results and eliminate the banding problem at least. So I did another setup a few days later comparing internal ProRes and 0 recording. Here is the 0 baseline. Now pushing the image beyond the usable limit of 3 stops, I was curious to see if I was able to recover the image at 3.5 stops under exposure, pushed back using 0. Unfortunately, the answer is no. 0 definitely holds the colors better than ProRes, which becomes greenish, but 0 shows these nasty speckles of chroma noise, which noise reduction cannot eliminate. Also the banding shows up in a similar way than before. Here is another comparison at 4.5 stops, unusable. Looking at these images, I cannot recommend 0. I actually prefer the ProRes over the 0 images, to be honest, because chroma noise is much better controlled. So far so good, that was our lab test. So as a summary, what can I say? On the one hand, I applaud the effort of the Chinese camera manufacturer Zcam to really provide low-cost cinema camera to the market. It's now a full-frame camera for $4,000 which shoots internal ProRes 422 10-bit footage, very high frame rates. This is huge. This is really amazing. On the other hand, while the dynamic range is more than enough for most shooting scenarios, be careful not to underexpose your footage, as banding can occur in the darker areas. So that's it for today. Thank you for watching. Let me know what you think in the comments below. And head over also to our website cinema5d.com, where you can find lots of stuff on cameras, articles, reviews and such. Thank you. Bye bye.